Thank you. And now, to entertain you tonight with a gala discussion and a recording session, Matt and Greg and the fabulous Beach Boys talk.
Hey everybody, and welcome. Matt, how you doing? Can you hear me? Uh-oh, Matt's video is frozen. What's going on? Matt, are you there? We lost Matt. All right, Matt is frozen. I'm going to kick Matt off for a second. Okay, let's hide Matt's view here. Is Matt there? Matt, you there? Can you say something, buddy?
I'm here. Hello, hello.
Oh, there we go. Hey, everybody. Welcome to another episode of Beach Boys Talk. This is a show dedicated to our favorite band. The Beach Boys, right, Matt?
That's right. We're not, experts, musicologists. We're just fans who love the Beach Boys, and we love coming here every week to talk about our favorite band and their songs and their music, and I'm just happy to be here. We have a great show tonight.
Yeah.
After being off, we're going to have on as our special guest tonight, author and musician Jon Stebbins.
Yep.
He's been a name since I've been younger, so I'm excited to speak with him.
Yeah.
And we're going to do the Many Moods of Matt. We're going to celebrate the news tonight. We have some news to share with everybody tonight, in the Beach Boys world. So,
oh, yeah. Yep, awesome.
It's going to be awesome.
It's going to be a lot of fun. I see, hi, Maggie. Hi, Joyce. Hey, Don. Hey, Sandy. Hey, Mons is in the house. Hey, Scott.
Hey,
hope
Monza.
Scott, you're doing. Hey, Sean. Claire, how you doing? How's England, Claire? Everything going well over there? Hope so. See the waves in the house. Matt is utilizing a Skynet server. Yeah, I don't know, Matt. Come on. Let's get your internet cooking over there. What happened?
It froze. It kicked me off, and then I popped right back on. So
it
I don't know what happened. So,
everything here is live, folks. This is a live show. We're not a podcast. We're 100% live. But hey, Marianne, how are you? Greg Shady's in the house. Yep, Ollie, how you doing? Jen, hey Jen, hope you're doing well. Thanks for being here. We're saying hi to all of our friends. It really means a lot, y'all coming. Can't hear a word, but then I do have an ear infection. Okay, Diane, Diane got. Got to get better. Diane has an ear infection. We need Diane to get better there for sure. Let's see. Hey, Bruce. How you doing? Bruce is from Windsor, Ontario. I think Windsor, is that like Toronto area, Matt?
I have no idea. But awesome that we have somebody on from Canada as well. Lots of countries represented here. It's pretty cool. So many Beach Boys fans around the world,
Yeah. Yeah, absolutely.
Very awesome.
Hi, Maura. How are you? Thanks for joining us. We're going to start our show off with a little tribute to Billy Hinchey. And before we while we're talking about Billy, Matt, you want to show off our awesome mugs here from Desiree? Can you guys see our mugs?
Our friend Desiree sent us these really beautiful mugs. On the one side, you can see it's got Billy Hinchey. And on the other side of the mug, it's just his guitar. And it was really nice of her to send those to us. We love Billy. We miss him. And we really appreciate you sending us those nice mugs. So got another awesome thing to use for the show. Thank you so much.
It's very thoughtful. Yes, thank you very much.
Yeah.
Hey, Matt from Texas, all the way from Texas in the house. How you doing? Hey, Paul. Paul says he can't hear. Paul, can everybody else hear okay? Everything going okay? Let me double check. Make sure. Yeah, I think we're good. I think everybody's hearing everything. So maybe just double check your speakers. Maybe hopefully you're not on mute there. But let's do a little tribute to Billy Hinchey. We always do. We do a song that he did on all of his shows. So we'll do a little bit of it as well. Hello, my friends. It's good to see you again. No, it's been a few years since we went away, and now I'm happy to say I'm doing okay myself. I can dig what's happening, and every day talk about them good old days. We laugh and say, hey, hey, Manny, you're okay. Let's take it nice and easy now. Back in the groove. Stick around for a little while and hey, good things are coming my way.
Rest in peace. Yeah.
How about some hearts? How about some love in the chat? You guys know how to do the emojis? Let's do some hearts in the chat for Billy. Let's send him up there for Billy Hinchy. Hopefully he's watching the show and having a good time. I can't help but think he would have a pretty funny joke to tell right now. One of those cheesy jokes.
Yeah, no doubt. We miss him. You know, such a great musician, and from what I understand, a really great, generous, kind man as well.
Yeah.
So we just want to honor that legacy.
Yep.
You know, this
yeah.
year especially.
Never got to have him on the show. He was scheduled to come on and didn't get a chance to. And that one's going to be a bummer for a long time. But with all of the friends we have on here, all of you out there that watch Billy's show and we're fans of Billy, we can kind of he's always with us a little bit, I think. So well, let's jump into the show. By the way, for those of you that are new, if you're new, feel free to tell us where you're from, your favorite Beach Boy album, and we'd love feel free to introduce yourself. We're always getting new people on every week, joining the family here, and we've got a great group of people. They're all really kind and very welcoming, so you're in good company. Matt, let's go ahead and do our first segment.
I got a special announcement. We have a friend here who's celebrating a birthday. He's a great friend of the show.
Yes, is he here?
Taylor Rudkin.
Taylor!
I want to say happy birthday to you, Taylor. I hope you're having a great day, and I appreciate you being on the show. I see you're on tonight, even on your birthday. That's
awesome, Taylor.
Man.
Yeah, man, you should be out getting drinks right now, man. Yeah.
So happy birthday
happy
to
birthday.
You. Hope it's a great day.
Happy birthday to Taylor. Yeah, yeah, huge friend of the show. You guys are all family, so anytime anybody celebrates a birthday, you gotta let us know. Hey, Allison. Allison's in the house.
Hey,
yes.
Allison.
Desiree, oh yeah, lots of hearts. Mary's given lots of hearts as well. Greg doesn't know how to do hearts. Can somebody help Greg? Somebody show Greg how to do the hearts. I love it, love it. Let's do our first segment of the night. It's my favorite segment, and it's called The Many Moods of Matt. Should we do it?
Let's do it.
The Many Moods of Matt.
Hey, Ray, welcome. Welcome, Ray, from Annapolis, Maryland. Surf's up.
Hey, Ray. Well, first of all, I wanted to say thank you. A big thank you to everybody, mostly friends here from our show, but that wished me a happy birthday. My birthday was last week, and it was really nice to get some nice notes and happy birthdays. And I also wanted to thank on stream here as well, my brother Greg, who got me this really nice gift. It's actually an original drum head. Let me see if I could show you here.
Nice shirt, man.
Well, thank you.
You got to show your shirt off, too.
So can you see it there? It says, to Matt.
To Matt, with good vibes from Bobby Figueroa.
Bobby Figueroa. So,
yeah, really
so Greg kind of worked that out for me to get me this neat drum head. And so I wanted to thank you, Greg, for thinking of me. It was very thoughtful. And I wanted to thank Bobby Figueroa for taking the time to do this for me. This is something I'm going to treasure forever. So thank you for that. So again, thank you for the birthday wishes. On that note, we have another very, other than Taylor, we have another very important birthday today. And so I wanted to wish founding Beach Boy member Mike Love a happy 81st birthday today. Happy birthday, Mike.
Happy birthday, Mike Love. Awesome.
And, you know, in thinking about his birthday, you know, we talk about Mike. Even in my my comments, I put a post on Facebook for happy birthday, Mike, and there were still some negative things about him that said, you know, he's not Brian, he's not this. But listen, I will say this, and I mean this till forever. As long as I'm a Beach Boy fan, without Mike Love, there's no Beach Boys, and I mean that.
Yeah.
And he started it early, you know, with the hooks, with the clever lyrics. You know, keeping it positive, keeping it commercial in a way. Now, I know that at some point in time in the history of the Beach Boys, you know, they argued, do we want to be commercial? Do we want to be progressive? But with that being said,
yeah,
the first album that the Beach Boys ever had that had no surf or car songs on it came out in March as well. And that's this beautiful album right here, one of my favorites of all time.
Cool.
And my point in showing you all this album is that Mike Love, except for the covers on this album, you know, the cover songs they do, Mike Love is a co-writer on every single song. So the thing is, there's really some amazing songs on there. Kiss Me Baby, She Knows Me Too Well, Please Let Me Wonder, When I Grow Up to Be a Man, Help Me Rhonda, among others, right? But the point is, for all the flack that Mike Love gets for whatever, the sun and the formula, he was into these progressive lyrics, into these more introspective lyrics. And so I really do believe that without Mike Love, there's no Beach Boys. And I want to say thank you to Mike, because throughout all these years, with all the tumultuous things that happened, he continues to tour. He still tours so much in a year, and he keeps that Beach Boy legacy going. And so, again, the last thing I'll just say is happy birthday, Mike. Thank you for the music you've given us. You know, without you, again, you're part of the band. You're an important part of the band. And thank you for that. Happy birthday.
The Many Moons Out.
Matt. Woo. Yeah, happy birthday, Mike Love. Yeah, Matt, you are so right. And the Today album, I think, has probably the, I'll maybe say, some of the best lyrics of any of their tunes. I mean,
yeah, man, you know, again, going from All Summer Long to Today, where you could kind of see the change in the All Summer Long album, but literally the first side is fast songs, the second side is the slow songs, but the slow songs are really, again, more introspective, a little bit more deep than what they wrote about with cars and surfing. But again, some of those lyrics, all the lyrics, I don't know, but at least some of them were written by Mike. So there's this idea that Mike did not want to do this stuff, wanted to always keep the car and the surfing, but it's not true. It's not even true in their albums when you look at them, you know? I think one of the biggest criticisms he gets is with the smile music, but to be fair, the smile music and the lyrics and all is very far out there. I mean, it really is, you know?
That's even out of context, right?
That's right.
Kind of crazy. So
I will say too, you know, that, you know, I don't think Mike Love had the best voice in the band. I think there's better singers, you know, there's better musicians, but again, he was more of the big picture guy, right? What do we want to do here? What are we going to do? He was a front man at times, not a front man at other times. He knew when to step back. But like I said, all those early hits, you got that classic Mike Love sound on him. Yes.
Hey, can I stop you right there and disagree real quick? Can I disagree with you?
Go ahead.
I think he was a great vocalist. In fact, I think his best vocals are the post surf and car stuff. And can I give you two examples of two of my favorite Mike Love vocals where I think he really shines, and I think he's just
absolutely
as good as some of the other guys. Let's do this one.
Now, before you do though, I want to say I didn't say he was a bad vocalist.
You
said finish
he was
my point.
Yeah.
Let me finish my point. My point was that you know, my point is that even though he wasn't the main musical songwriter.
Yeah.
He wasn't the best voice in the band. Carl and Al, you know, Brian, he's so intricate to those.
I'm just saying that's debatable. That's all I'm saying.
Okay. But he's so intricate to those harmonies in the bass line, and you don't have those iconic Beach Boy sound without his leads. I Get Around, right? For example, fun, you know, all that stuff. That was my point.
Well, so I think it's debatable, especially because you have to throw Dennis in there and Bruce in there. And I would argue that Mike, especially these two tunes I'm about to play a little bit of, I think you might agree with me that I think Mike might have a better vocal. And I think you could contend for the spot of kind of next up between the three of those guys. You know, I think it's kind of a,
and let's be fair, because I see a couple things in the chat that say Mike Love didn't get credited with these lyrics until lawsuits. But look, when the Beach Boys put out Surfing USA at first, they didn't credit Chuck Berry, right?
Yeah, pretty crazy.
But we know that Chuck Berry wrote the music to that song. So just because credit for the lyrics came later doesn't mean Mike Love didn't write them, right? I think at the time they weren't thinking about that stuff, and it was way later. So that's my opinion on it. But go ahead, let's celebrate Mike's birthday, Greg.
Okay, two vocals I'm about to prove you wrong right here. You ready?
I didn't say it was bad. Go ahead.
You said he was the worst vocalist in the group.
I didn't say that either. I said he may not be the best vocalist in the group. That's exactly what I said.
let's see. I had to prove that I can make it alone now, but that's not me. I wanted to show how independent I'd grown now, but that's not me. I could try to be big in the eyes of the world. What matters to me is what I could be to just one girl. I'm a little bit scared cause I haven't left home in a long time.
Yeah, that's a great one.
Okay, there's that one, and then there's this one. I don't know the lyrics super well. Today could be a lot of fun, and precious one, I feel good just to walk with you. Tonight'll be a special treat. You're so sweet, and I feel good just to walk with you. You know that you've been a long time loving me, and say that you've been a long time needing you. And don't you know that there's so much more to come? I got a love that just won't stop beating for you. Ooh, I got a love that just won't stop beating for you.
Yeah, and of course,
awesome vocals from Mike. Awesome.
Meant for You is another highlight. Oh. All I Want to Do from the Sunflower album is another highlight. I like his vocals a lot on the Love You album as well. Airplane, I love that vocal too. So.
Oh, All I Want to Do. We talked about
All
that
I Want to Do from Sunflower. Yep. Yeah. So he's one of the song that I posted for his birthday tribute today was Big yeah. Sur, the one from Feel Flows. That's mm-hmm. a great vocal too.
Yeah. Yeah.
So his voice matured a little bit. And I'll tell you one thing that made a difference with Mike, my opinion, and there's Les in the house. Hey, Les, glad you're here.
Hey, Les.
And Nolan. Hey, Nolan. Nolan's here. Nolan. Nolan's got a great show, y'all. Check it out. Nolan Carr at Night on YouTube.
Stop what you're doing. Go watch Nolan Carr show. Really,
yeah,
really
Nolan Carr at Night, yeah.
Yeah.
But when they stopped double tracking his voice and they gave him songs to sing that had a little bit more, like an emotion to him, you know, because the early songs, they're pretty simple, you know, and again, yeah. that's not a critique. Hey, it was just more a formulaic thing. You know what I'm saying?
So. Bobby D just brought up Here Today is one of Mike's best vocals too.
Oh yes.
He's all over Pet Sounds in a really a lot of ways. And it's pretty awesome. Hey, Night Out. Hey, Darren, how you doing? Mike sings Do It Again remake with the Surf Ray Rocks. Safari Rocks. I haven't seen that.
I don't know that one.
I haven't seen that one. Joe, Kiss Me Baby. Oh, dude, Kiss Me Baby. He's got great vocals on that one.
Fritz says, yeah. Mike Love deserves the credit he eventually got. It speaks volumes that the jury awarded Mike credit for all 72 songs he contested authorship of. The evidence was overwhelming. And there's Fritz. I don't think we've seen you here before. Thanks for being here.
Who is that, Matt?
Fritz.
Hey, Fritz.
Ward. Yeah.
Fritz. Hey, Fritz. Welcome. Yeah.
Yeah. So, you know, I just, I don't get all the, I get that there's things, but when you're a band for 60 years, you're going to have the warts and all, right? There's going to be stuff that happens that's not so great in any band's history. And I just feel like sometimes Mike Love is unfairly maligned, and we overlook the contributions that he made and the importance he had to the band, you know?
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. Oh, mm-hmm. Oh, Do It Again with Sugar Ray. Yeah, Sugar Ray.
Oh, Sugar Ray, yeah. And Stamos is in that video, I think.
Man, embarrassingly, I used to listen to Sugar Ray in middle school. Is that bad? All right, Matt, you want to move over to our news segment? So we do another segment called Celebrate the News. We have some news to talk about, Matt, I think, right?
We do. Let's do it.
All right, hit him with it, Matt.
This just in. I saw, and I know a lot of you saw this today on Facebook, but Al Jardine wishing Mike Love a very happy birthday. However, he said, can't wait to see you at the reunion.
Oh, I did it. I did it too. Hold on.
Can't wait to see you at the reunion.
What does that mean, Matt? Chat.
That's right.
What does that mean? What is he talking about?
So really the news is that Al, now here's the thing. When the 2012 reunion came out,
yeah.
Al was the one to spill the beans first about it in the press. In fact, I wrote him a letter and he wrote back to me, see you at Bonnaroo. I have it hanging up in another room.
Oh, snap.
So he told me about the reunion, not that, you know, as a fan. So
wait,
maybe
so are
he's
you saying
onto
that,
something.
Are you saying that maybe a letter to you is incoming? Are you saying
no,
you
I'm
may
not
be
saying
the first
that,
to
but
know?
I'm saying that Al has a – from the 50th anniversary tour, Al hinted at it, literally said it was going to happen, and it happened. So yeah, I wonder what.
But what does that
happy
mean?
Happy birthday, Mike. See you. Can't wait to see what the reunion means. It could mean a lot of things, right?
Well, it more than like. I mean, the odds are that it means something that we don't know about that's maybe happening, right, but it's not necessarily the reunion. But there's also a chance.
Maybe it's a reunion. They're having a birthday party or something. You know, I don't know. That's the thing. Who knows?
Roberta has the goosebumps, Matt. Keep going. Roberta, how you doing?
I mean, could you imagine just one more time? We know.
One more.
Now they're all.
We'll be there.
Octogenarians, if that's the right word. Brian will be one in June. You know, they're in their 80s.
Did you just use the word octogenarians?
I think it's a word, right? It's going to be time for them to hang it up. But 60th anniversary, I would definitely go. I don't know what the reunion means. But I'd love to see David, and let's keep Blondie in the band this time.
Why don't we just do
let's
everybody? I would love to see Bobby back there. Can you?
Bobby? Let's get Bobby.
Them.
Yeah.
I mean, why
Bobby
not?
Figueroa.
What do you have to lose? I mean, just do it. I mean, is my thing about it.
Carly
is
Munoz, bring them all back.
Yeah, it can't be about the money anymore. I mean, I get it. No. You have to pay people. But, I mean, man, it would be fantastic for them just to all get together and kind of celebrate. But, love it.
The legacy, you know. So anyway, I don't know if anybody is privy to any of that news. I'm sure you already would have posted it on Facebook, but if you ever hear anything, let us know, because I want to know what that means, you know. And unfortunately, I don't know Al, so I can't call him and ask him, but it would be cool.
that's true. Well, let's see. Allison says, I hope the reunion means a tour, us too. Sean O'Grady says, would love to see a 60th show. Gail says, and Ricky. Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
I love it. I love it. Joyce says, all of them. Yeah, absolutely. Hi, Maria. I hope they will do a 60th anniversary with everyone, including Blondie, Ricky, and David. Absolutely.
Exactly.
That's right. Tony says, Bobby is a great drummer. He added so much to Al's shows just being there. Man, I really wish we could have seen the shows. You know, he was really only on the East Coast and the super far West Coast. So maybe he'll make a... make a trip to the Midwest. What do you think? That would be awesome.
Yeah, I hope so. And we'll Les makes a good point. Bobby Figueroa is already touring with Al on the tour that Al.
I know.
Completed.
That's why it makes sense. Just do it.
Yep.
You know, I love it. Yep. So, Allison says, I'm going to see Mike on Friday. If I get to talk to him, I'll ask about what this reunion means. Allison, I appreciate it. Can you also throw in, we would love to have him on the show.
Talk about it on the show and tell
just
him.
Work it in there
Allison,
a little bit.
Tell Allison that we said happy birthday. We did a little tribute for him on the show. So
do not mention that that Matt said that he is the worst vocalist in the group. I would not mention
didn't
that part.
Say that.
I wouldn't mention that. But
well,
yeah.
You can't mention that because it'd be a lie. So
Allison, when you're talking with him, just kind of sneak it in there. Be like, oh, by the way, so, you know, there's this show called Beach Boys Talk, and really cool. They're both really handsome, really intelligent guys. I'd love to have you love you on the show. You know, just exchange numbers.
Joseph has a good point. He said, ask John. Yeah, we'll ask John if he knows anything about it when he comes on for sure. But
yeah,
guest Jon Stebbins. Yep.
Do you think, you know what? He sent us a bunch of pictures. By the way, tonight's interview is going to be really cool. I think we're going to do it a different way than we do a lot of our interviews. And I'm really excited to do it this way. But he's got pictures with all the guys. I mean, I think he's definitely in the circle. It'd be kind of cool to maybe get his thoughts on the on a possible reunion.
Yeah.
It'd be kind of cool. Hey, Michael, thanks for liking the stream. Good to see you. Hi, Cindy. Don't say he's an octogenarian.
Well, he is. He's 81. That means he's in his 80s.
Are you
right?
Sure it's not octogenarian? Are you sure it's not octogenarian?
I don't know. Maybe I flubbed it. Sorry.
I don't know. Yeah.
Whatever. Yeah. It was a word that came to mind. So, Greg, here's the thing. And maybe our friends can tell us, do you think, if the Beach Boys do a 60th,
thanks Buzz.
60 is not the same as 50, obviously, you know what I mean? Like 50 is like a bigger deal. Do you think there would be not for us big Beach Boys fans, there would be, you know, to want to go see them, but what do you think to the, like, you know, the bigger scheme, just general audiences say, oh, Brian's back with Mike again. Do you think do you think people would come again like they did for the 50th?
I don't know. Probably, yeah. But for me, I'm with you, Matt. I would much rather see more of like a retrospective thing where it's a little bit more they already did the 50th. I don't need them to do the 50th thing again where they're all like playing Do It Again. And, you know, I would love for them to like sit down and do a tour of like a round table. Maybe it's not so like physically demanding, and they can maybe talk about Carl. You know, I don't just like get it, sit around and have a little, and maybe they could get who is the Rolling Stones guy? Maybe we can ask Brent to talk to him.
Jason Fine.
Maybe Jason Fine could be like the guy. Not him, but you know, I'm sure he's busy. But
something like that.
Somebody like that to like ask, be the moderator, ask the questions, and then maybe they do a couple songs. You know, but nothing. I feel like it'd be a little tough to try and do that again. I mean, they are octogenarian
is correct. Thank you, Buzz. Thank you, Don. Oh, and by the way, I don't
who
have
uses
any,
that. Okay, let's. Who uses that word and is not trying hard?
I don't have any inside information, I promise. But the thing that I think is more realistic that would happen and I would love is almost like a reunion, like kind of like you're saying, Greg, but almost like a television concert kind of thing where they get together and they play some songs.
Yeah.
But then you have some guests, you know, guest vocalists, guests who come on and play their songs.
Yeah.
Kind of like they did at the Brian Wilson tributes that, you know, David Leaf did one of those. I think that would be cool, too. I think a tour, though. Where they tour the country and the world again is a lot to ask guys in their 80s, you know.
Yeah.
But Mike still does it. That's the thing. That was one of the things that impresses me about Mike is that he's still doing all that.
Yeah,
Mike and Bruce,
pretty,
right?
Pretty crazy. So Maria says they should do a Love You tour, but I doubt that will ever happen. Yeah, me too.
Oh, man.
Maria. But that would be
awesome.
Amazing. Like all of them? Can you like Al sing and Susie Cincinnati? Wait.
No, well,
no.
Honking Down the Highway.
Honking Down the Highway. Sorry, yeah. Susie. That's 15 big ones, isn't it?
Yeah, that would be that would rock.
Ollie,
I hear Brian sing "The Night Is So Young."
Hey, Kathy, thanks for liking the stream. Ollie says, "Isn't everyone booked up until October?" Yeah, I know. That's what I saw that. I thought about that too. So it must be maybe for the year after that. Then
saw that too. Tony said, "Soprano." Tony said, "Unplugged version of the songs." That would be really cool.
Yeah.
If they just do a laid back. That's why I mean, for a TV thing, that would be neat. Just to have.
Yeah.
Maybe, you know, like maybe Jeff Foskett in the background. And,
how great would see Jeff, yeah.
And, you know, Scott Totten and a couple other guys to to fill it in, but just have the boys there singing. That would be sweet.
Well, selfishly, we want all the guys that have been on our show too, right?
Yeah, of course. But
yeah. Let's see. Mara says, I just want one show televised. Do it right, but do it. Mara, I'm with you. I would love that. That would be great.
I think I'm good with that. Make a nice DVD, but don't do what they did with the 50th DVD and CD. That thing is so... overdone with the auto tune and stuff.
Well,
it doesn't sound live anymore.
I don't know how you avoid that though, right? I mean,
well, when I go to a concert, I've never left a concert live saying, "Wow, that was terrible." It doesn't happen, you know. So
fix
a little bit of it, but
yeah, but remember,
you know.
there's a huge difference between being at a live show and then watching it in your living room, right? I think you're a little bit more attentive to the way they sound versus the experience of being there having a beverage and like kind of being surrounded by a bunch of fans. I don't know that you're.
I'm just saying, don't overdo it. I understand you want to correct some things, but I feel like that 50th one was too much. That's all.
Yeah.
I'm saying,
well, they bugged me too because they redid the Nebworth show too. I mean, it's all that whole thing is auto-tuned, you know, and it's kind of like, come on, I as a Beach Boy fan, the people that are buying it, I don't know that they want to hear the actual. Like, I'd love to hear Carl singing. I don't want to hear a robot singing, you know, pretending to be Carl. So,
no doubt, I agree.
Anyway, let's see. 50th may have been it. If so, very thankful for that reunion. Absolutely, Joseph. It was a great, great show. Allison says I'd be down for a televised live performance as long as it's actually shown live and not overdubbed. Yeah, 100%
right.
Allison.
Agree, and I don't think that's what I mean.
Hey, Butch,
thank you
for liking the stream.
I don't think in my own heart they're going to go on another big tour. And again, when Al says the reunion, again, we don't know what that means. There's lots of things it could mean, but he didn't say can't wait to see you on tour again. He said reunion. So to me, maybe it's a one-off kind of thing. You know, who knows?
Sandy says they should do a hologram Dennis and Carl appearing. That would be kind of crazy.
That would be neat. Interesting. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. I love it. Mm-hmm. All right. Well,
we have another set of news, right?
Do we?
What's the other set of news? Hold on.
Oh, I thought we had about Al's concert.
Oh, we do. They're just not here yet.
Okay.
So way to blow that.
Well, it's 7:30. I'm sorry. Live TV.
There goes that. Everybody, we are not perfect at this. We are not perfect to say that. But we
what I wanted to say was, here they come.
There you go.
I wanted to say we actually have correspondents in the field that are coming to report back. To Beach Boys talk.
Hold on.
On some of the sweet stuff going on. And one of our correspondents coming on here is our friend from the show, Scott Meshnick.
Hey, Scott, how's it going? Scott, can you hear us okay?
I can hear you, yes.
All right. And I think we have one more possibly joining us, right? I think we have two correspondents out in the field. Everybody, y'all know Scott. Scott's part of the Beach Boy Talk family. Welcome. Please do me a favor.
Got a great YouTube channel with how to play
Fantastic.
Beach Boy songs. Check
Fantastic.
That out. Scott, what's your site on YouTube?
Oh, Matt.
Fuel Flows 409.
Love it.
And our other correspondent, everybody, you all know Evan Hawley. Evan Hawley from his YouTube videos. His,
Evan,
how you doing? Can you hear us okay?
Yeah.
Awesome.
Yeah, can you hear me?
Yeah, we hear you great. And I'm sorry the video is not super great, everybody. I didn't think this through. But everybody, we had these guys on because Scott, Evan, you guys were recently at an Al Jardine family and friends show, right?
Mm-hmm. We were.
Awesome.
We ran into one another just randomly at the show.
I love it.
So awesome.
Do you guys want it? Maybe we'll start with Scott and then we'll go to Evan. And then Scott, so you guys can each kind of tell us your experience of the entire time seeing the show.
That works.
Yeah, go ahead. Go ahead, Scott.
Yeah.
So, let's see. Where do I begin?
Tell us about the whole thing, man.
The whole thing? So, yeah. I grew up in that area. So, Norwalk is like right near where I grew up as a kid. So, it was an easy drive because I live kind of still in the area. And Al was great. The concert was great. I'll get into that in just a moment. But as I was at the concert, as I mentioned before, mm-hmm. I looked over to my right and I'm like, wait a minute, isn't that Evan? I recognized him. He had his mask down for a little bit and I was just spotted him.
Nice.
And his mother was there, you know?
Nice.
And I was like, wait a minute, I gotta go up to him and I gotta say something. So I introduced myself and we met in person. And yeah, it was a good conversation. We were both wearing, all three of us, including Evan's mother, we were wearing custom made Keeping It Clean with Al Jardine shirts.
That's great.
I love it.
Evan, did you wear that last time you were on here, which was like, what, 2 weeks ago, I think?
Yeah, I did. Yeah.
That same shirt. Yeah. I had one of a slightly different design that I was wearing. But as you and I were talking, and your mom was in the talking with us too, Marianne Jardine actually exited, and Marianne is Al's wife.
Yeah.
She exited one of the side doors and commented on our shirt. She was like, oh, I love your shirts. And we were like, oh, thank you. And then afterwards we were like, isn't that Marianne Jardine?
That's cool.
That's really cool.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So that was cool.
Yeah.
Concert was great. I don't know, like the set list, if you've seen set lists, we were at the Norwalk show. It was the same set list, I think, for all the shows and the tour. Everything sounded great. I love seeing Bobby Figueroa on drums.
Yeah.
This is my first time seeing Ed Carter on bass because, like, I'm not old enough to have seen him play live. So that was my first time
seeing
him. That is
really cool. Yeah.
Carney and Wendy were in top form vocally, I thought. I thought they were, like, among the highlights, and there were a lot of highlights locally, but like they were excellent. And yeah, I don't know, like that was it. But actually Al, during the show, so I was sitting literally at his feet pretty much.
Yeah.
So he spotted my shirt, my Keeping It Clean with Al Jardine shirt. And I noticed him spotting it. Like he was playing, you know, in the middle of a song.
Mm-hmm.
And I could just like verbally, like he non-verbally acknowledged it. He kind of chuckled and kind of gestured at it in a friendly way.
Nice.
And after the final encore, after they took their bows, Al actually said to me, like he directed this at me, keeping it clean.
Oh, nice.
I shall.
That's man, great. That is awesome. Hey, before we move on to Evan, Scott, I have a question. You mentioned the set list and I didn't look at the set list too much, but did they play anything that kind of surprised you or was neat to hear that you hadn't heard before?
I liked hearing Wendy on Sail on Sailor.
Oh,
that was new. A lot of people were thinking that Bobby would take lead on that because he did so. Wasn't I believe that was like the 80s, right?
Oh, I thought you were talking about the song Wendy. Okay, never mind.
I'm talking about Sail on Sailor.
Like Wendy Sail on Sailor mashup? Like what was that?
No.
Wendy Wilson.
Yeah. Singing Sail on Sailor. So that was surprising. They kept Wake the World and Add Some Music to Your Day.
Oh, cool.
In the set list from Brian's shows. They kind of performed it very similarly to how it's performed at Brian's live shows. Mm-hmm. And I don't know. I feel like I'm missing one song, Evan. Am I missing anything?
Well, Postcard from California.
That too.
Oh.
Yes.
Oh.
That was during the encore, and it was great. As
yeah,
always.
It's a great song.
Yeah.
That's cool.
For sure.
Evan, what's your take on the show?
Well, you know, Scott pretty much put it, you know, and pretty much how it was. You know, Al was, you know, there were a couple of spots where he kind of, you know, screwed up a couple of lyrics here and there, but his yeah. voice was really, really on point. You yeah. know, his voice was just really, really good. And for him being 81 years old and for him being able to maintain that voice, it's just amazing.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. Sounds like it was awesome. Did Carney and Wendy sing any did they sing any of their songs from Wilson Phillips?
Yeah.
They did. Yes.
I know this pain.
How did that go over? Was it good?
It was great.
I thought their numbers, their songs were like sonically extremely impressive. Like
cool.
That's kind of why I say like they were in top form. Is I was really impressed with how those songs sounded.
Interesting.
Huh.
So
yeah.
they were a real highlight for you guys, huh?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, Wendy singing Impulsive was really cool too. I like that.
Oh, nice.
And they sing a song off of, it's escaping me, but the album they did in the 90s with Brian, together with him, what was
right.
that called?
I do not know the name of that, but I know what you're talking about. Yeah.
Yeah. It was not well promoted. Even Carney even said it out loud in the introductions of the song. It's like, wasn't well promoted, but a lot of great songs on there. Al loves this tune.
Maybe Monday Without You, maybe.
Yeah. That's the one. Yep. Yeah.
That's it.
Oh, nice.
That was Tony Soprano in the chat helping you guys out there.
Thank you.
Yeah. Yeah, Beach Boy fan.
Thank you, Tony.
You guys are awesome. We should just do this all the time. You guys are a ton of fun. I love you guys. I love our Beach Boy Talk family. You guys have been there for a long time. Evan, we got to get you on again and do a Ripcord show, man.
Heck yeah.
Yeah. And actually, I've got something here.
Yeah, yeah.
I actually got the Postcard from California album signed by almost everybody in the band except Al.
What? Oh, man, we got to fix that. We got to fix that.
Was kind of funny. Yeah. So let's see. So there's, I don't know if you can see it very good, but
yeah looks great.
There's Matt Jardine's right there.
Nice. Nice.
Then I got Ed Carter's.
That's cool signature right there. Ed Carter. Yeah.
Then Bobby Figueroa right there.
Cool.
Nice.
Cool.
And then on the back, I got Proben Gregory's.
Oh, cool. He's a friend of the show. That's awesome.
Yeah. That's awesome, Evan.
I actually got to actually talk with Matt and Proben for a little bit, too, which was really cool.
Oh, that's great. That's great. Yeah, they're really nice.
Yeah.
Guys. They're all so nice. Everybody in that.
Yeah, they are.
They're really, really sweet people. So that's awesome.
I think it's pretty cool that you guys recognize each other and we're able to talk at the show. That's pretty neat too.
That is,
you know,
really cool.
Our little Beach Boy bubble here. It's pretty sweet.
Yeah.
So. Sounds like it was
a
great show. Hey, I got to ask you guys another question. What was the attendance like? Was it a good crowd?
Yes. Mm-hmm. I was actually really pleased with how well it sold.
Yeah.
Really?
Because I was kind of worried about that. I had heard there's low, not as many people buying tickets.
Yeah.
But then when I was actually there, I mean, I don't know if it sold out, but it came close if it didn't sold out. Wouldn't you say, Evan?
Yeah. What was really nice is the theater that we were at was a pretty small theater. The max capacity was I think 700 or something like that.
Okay.
And they were pretty close to selling out the whole thing. So it was really cool. It was almost sold out.
Yeah.
Great.
Man, I'm really hoping he comes somewhere we can go, Matt. I think it'd be really, really
I know.
Really
he didn't come to the
that.
Midwest out where I am. I hope if anybody's listening from his camp here, do more shows. It sounds like they were successful. And I'll say the fact that he can't tour on his own, you know, with the Beach Boys name, and he has to go by Al Jardine to have a crowd like that. It's pretty impressive, actually. So I think that means there's a demand to see him in that incarnation of folks he has in the band, you know? So yeah. I'm happy for all those folks. They got to go out there again and do that. So
yeah. Yeah. Really cool. Guys, I have one more question before we let you go. Is that okay? Can we keep you for just a little bit longer?
Absolutely.
Awesome.
Oh yeah.
Awesome. Hey, guys, are we having a reunion or not? And would you like one? What do you think?
Evan, you go first.
Okay. Okay. This is what I have to say. I don't know. I think Al was just kind of being a little, he was just kind of joking around, I think. Mm-hmm. I think he was just kind of just doing it. Now, I'm not sure whether there's going to be a reunion. Mm-hmm. And if there is, like you guys were saying, I don't think there's going to be a tour. I think it's just going to be a smaller thing just because they don't really seem like they're going to do something like that. Like, it just doesn't seem right because they've been apart for so long and it doesn't really seem, I don't know. It wouldn't seem right if they were to do it again, because would they be happy? Would they get upset? Would the same thing happen that happened last time? We don't know.
Mm-hmm.
So
yeah.
Yeah. I'm of the same mind. But I was fortunate enough to see two of the reunion shows and almost went to a third.
Nice.
Which I'll never forget for the rest of my life. But I agree with you, Evan. I think he was joking and maybe messing with the fans along with it. But at the same time, it's Al, and Al, when he spills the beans about something or when he mentions something like this, usually it comes true. It's happened many times in the past. So I'm not going to say that it's an impossibility. But like you, I don't think that anything on the scale of the 50th reunion tour is in the cards. Yeah. I would be shocked if it was.
Yeah.
50th reunion tour, they had a brand new album to promote. I don't think that will, well, who knows? But I kind of doubt that they would have that potentially, but I may be wrong. That's pretty much what I feel like. I think it's more likely that they may do a couple of concerts in key cities. And
Scott, that bedspread rocks, man. By the way.
Thank you.
Is that the sunflower?
Feel flows.
Dang.
Feel flows bed sheets.
Dang. That's amazing. That's awesome. I love it. Evan, do you have Feel Flows bed sheets?
No, but I do have a couple of big posters up in my room here.
Oh, well, Evan, you're not a real fan until you have bed sheets, man. Come on, get on Scott's level here. you got to one up him and get like Mike Love's face on your pillow.
No, that's okay.
Yeah.
Man, you guys, sounds like you had a really, really great experience.
Yeah, super jealous.
I envy y'all, but thank you for sharing with us. That was really cool.
I got an idea. How about the next time there's a show somewhere we're all close? You guys are in New York, right? Evan, aren't you in Rochester?
Yeah, I'm in that area, yeah.
Yeah, okay, next time, Scott, next time there's something in like the New York, Pennsylvania, we're all road tripping. And the entire Beach Boy Talk fam, we need to go to one show. And then we can, like, we'll rent out a place, like, beforehand or afterwards for, like, an after party. We all hang out. It'll be really fun.
That would be fun.
I think we do that.
Scott,
you can bring your bed sheets to show off to everybody. That'd be awesome. It'd be really sick. You guys are the best. Can we do this again?
Yes.
Definitely.
Awesome. Definitely down for that.
All right, fellas.
Love
you guys,
it. Thanks, guys.
You guys take care. Thanks again for joining us, and thanks for the info on the concert. You guys take it easy.
Thanks.
All right. Thank you.
Thanks, guys. And that's us celebrating the news. We had some
nice
correspondence on the scene. Yeah.
It does sound
like, I'm really glad Al went out and did those shows. I think it's neat. Carney and Wendy were there, and Matt Jardine, of course. But to bring back Ed Carter, who played bass with the Beach Boys since
the '60s,
right?
Man, pretty classy. Keeping the I mean,
and Bobby, yep.
I mean, Al and Matt, those guys could probably have any drummer, any keyboard player, any guitar player that they want in the country that would probably jump at the chance to come and be on the road with them, especially for the short run of shows. But the fact that they went to Bobby and Ed, and like, it's just like, I don't know. I just think it's really touching. It's very, like, very family oriented group. And you want to be a part of that, you know, it's really fun.
Yeah, exactly. And I'd love, again, I'd love to see that show with that incarnation. Cause again, Bobby was, when he came on our show, remember, he was on so many of those big important Beach Boys shows, you know, in the 70s and 80s. And Ed Carter 's been there since 67, pretty much. I mean, they're Beach Boys in my book, you know, so it's pretty awesome.
I love it.
Yeah, very cool. That was awesome.
Well, we got T minus about 10 minutes before we welcome on our special guest author. We got Jon Stebbins. Now, I say author, but he's also an accomplished musician. He's a writer, but this is one of his books that he did with Ian Rustin. And Matt, I think we're trying to get Ian Rustin on as well. Man, it would be great to have him on.
We're working on that. Now, I have two of the books that he wrote. One of them is this one right here. It's called The Real Beach Boy, Dennis Wilson. This is hard to find now. I got to thank our friend Michael for this book. But
Matt, you need to turn around and sell that for like $3,000 on Amazon.
I know. And then we actually are going to do a giveaway tonight.
Yeah.
We asked on Facebook if you could tell us about your favorite Beach Boy concert experience. And if you're on live tonight, you have a chance to win this book right here.
Yeah.
Which is called The Beach Boys in Concert. It's a beautiful hardcover book.
That's right.
And
it
this,
is.
Oh, Greg, that's the one you have. Yeah.
It's
this
well
is the
done,
book
yeah.
with Jon Stebbins and Ian Rustin.
And
it's
Ian
a
Rustin.
Great. This is really a great book. And whoever wins, you're getting something real valuable.
Yeah, and we've already picked our winners. So we did a Facebook on our Facebook group. And if you're not part of our Facebook group, get in there. We welcome everybody. We did a Facebook question. What was your favorite live show experience? Right, Matt? And we've already picked the one, and we picked a backup too, just in case the person wasn't here tonight.
Yeah.
So,
and I got to say, reading through all those stories were really cool.
Pictures.
There's so many fans that have had really neat experiences with the Beach Boys and at their concerts. So it was really cool to read all those. Yeah.
I love it. Matt, why don't we do, so that, you know, cause we usually don't have a time at the end of the show. Do you want to take a couple requests before we hop into Jon and, we're going to do, let's do a little bit of requests. You guys have a song you want to hear, a Beach Boys song you want to hear. We'd love to play a couple here before we welcome.
And I'd love
Jon
to push it in the request, maybe in honor of Mike Love's birthday, maybe pick a song you like that Mike sings.
That's a really good idea. How about your favorite Mike Love vocal or song or lyric or something like that in honor of Mike on his birthday? We'll do a couple songs before we welcome on Jon and do that interview. Matt, I'm so excited for this interview with Jon.
I am
Stebbins.
Too. You know,
it's gonna be really fun.
He's again, since I got back into the Beach Boys in the early 2000s, Jon Stebbins' name has always been around. He's been on documentaries. You know, he's just always there. He's been on those message boards. You know, so he's another guy I'm really excited to speak with, because he's another guy kind of in the Beach Boy family. You know. That's been around for quite some time.
Matt, I got a few requests for All I Want to Do. Let's do that
one. All
right,
play that one. That's one of, in my opinion, that's Mike Love's best Beach Boys vocal. I think we talked about that on a show before, but it's beautiful. Great song, too. Wow, See the Wave says he has the Dennis Wilson book signed by Jon Stebbins. That's pretty sweet.
That's awesome. By the way, whoever requested Carl's Big Chance, you are awesome, but I'm not doing Carl's Big Chance. Is this Carl's Big Chance?
Yeah, I think so, yeah.
And he just plays it.
Off a Little Deuce Coupe, which you said was one of their worst albums of the 60s, by the way.
It is one of their worst albums of the 60s, and we'll have that conversation for another day. But
Joe Rise is on. Hey, Joe. He said Big Sir. But I think
Big Sir.
Start with All I Want to Do and maybe throw in the Big Sir. That
yeah,
sounds
by
good.
The way, Joe is an honored guest. I don't know if you guys know, but Joe is in one of the biggest Pink Floyd cover bands in the country. Like, they sell out like arenas and stuff, man. It's pretty crazy. The dude
awesome
is
stuff.
Awesome.
We're
keyboard
honored
player.
To have him here. And I wanted to give another shout out. We saw Les on the show. Les is back. Les, your story's inspiring. You've been sharing it on Facebook. So y'all go check him out. But he's going to be coming back. He does a lot of beautiful Beach Boys remixes of songs and remasters and stuff.
Yeah,
so
awesome stuff.
Another great friend of the show. Happy that you're here with us, Les.
Good to my baby.
Oh, that's a good one.
Monza wants to hear that. Ben 006, All I Want to Do. Okay, yeah, let's do All I Want to
Do. It again. Oh, yeah, we got enough here. Yeah.
I really like Good to My Baby. We should do that one.
That is a good one. The Today album, yeah.
Oh yeah, we're doing that one. But let's do this one. We only can do a couple here. Let's do this'll be fun. Madam, I need your help on the lyrics.
I don't know if I know that one that well, but we could try.
This one? Let's do this one. Let's make it really, really reverb-y.
Nice. Man, beautiful song. Oh, I got to give a shout out, though. Awesome. I just saw in the chat, Greg.
Yeah.
Another legend is with us right now. Ed Roach is with us right now. I can't believe it.
Man, it's so cool.
Hello,
the
Ed. Thank
you
for being here.
Ed, everybody, Ed, we would love to have you on the show. We're going to shoot our shot right now. Ed, please come on the show. We would love to have you. It would be amazing.
You
everybody say
very,
hi to Ed Roach.
Close to Dennis. Appreciate all those beautiful pictures you've taken throughout the years.
Can we do Good to My Baby before we
do it?
That one sounded really fun to do. I don't think we've ever have we ever done Good to My Baby on the show?
I'm not sure, man. I think we may have one time.
Good to My Baby lyrics. I feel like I know the lyrics.
From the Today album. It was just not even a single, but such a great hit, you know, great song. Again, about 5 more minutes and we'll have on our special guest Jon Stebbins coming on Beach Boys Talk. Some crazy key changes in there, right?
Yeah, we'll figure it out.
You got it, brother.
Well, let's take that off. Sorry.
They think I'm bad and I treat her so mean. But all they know is from what they see. When I get her alone now, you know we're as happy as a couple could be. And when I give her my love, it's between her and me. She's my girl and I'm good to my baby. She's my girl. Friends now, you know we never have to put on a show. We stay together while other couples come and go. My girl and I'm good to my baby. She's my girl, so be good to my baby. I know she's happy with me. Thank you.
All right, Matt, do this part.
Good to my baby.
Good to my baby. She's my girl and I'm good to my baby. She's my girl and I'm good to my baby. She's my girl and I'm good to my baby. She's my girl and I'm good to my baby.
That's a classic Beach Boys song, yeah. And Mike, again, and Mike's got the lyrics on there. Again, yeah. They're a little bit, you know, deeper than all the albums before, you know, kind of more talking about relationships and things, and it's awesome stuff. So,
yeah, yeah, I love it. By the way, I saw a couple people asking who those two guys were that we had on, Matt. And Scott has been joining the show for a long time now. He's been watching, but he always has great insights. You know, I think he's a great Beach Boy mind. He's got a great historian, knows a lot about the band, real smart guy. And so he's a friend of the show, just like all of you. And then the younger guy, Evan, is a guy we found on YouTube. We were just kind of going through YouTube, and he did a YouTube album review of
He's done a couple, but he did Sunflower.
The one I saw, I think, was Summer Days.
Summer Days, yeah 2020 as well. Yeah,
yeah, just really, it was awesome. And so we were like, man, we got to have him on the show. He just seems like a cool kid. And so they're both super friends of the show, and we love having them on.
And
it
just
energy.
Happened to be that the reason we had them on again with our news, they happened to be at the same show.
They were at the same show together.
Recognized each other because of our meetings here. So that was really, really cool to know that, you know, making some friendships, you know.
Well, Matt, I think it's time to welcome on our honored guest, Jon. Jon, can you hear us? Oh, he's connecting the audio right now. Okay. Jon, we're hanging on for you here. It just says it connecting to audio, so we'll give it a second here.
There he is. Hello, Jon.
Hello.
Jon, hey. Man, thank you so much for joining us. How are you this evening?
We're doing good. You guys can hear me and see me, I assume.
We hear you and see you perfectly. You look great.
wife's my roadie, so she's... This is Nadia.
Hey, Nadia. Hey.
Hello, Nadia.
Nadia, hey, thanks
good
for...
Good evening, you guys.
Good evening. Thanks for Have letting fun. Us steal Jon. Yeah, we really appreciate it.
Yeah, we're excited. We're stoked.
Yeah. Hey, everybody. Jon. Yeah, Jon Stebbins is joining us. How about some welcome, some highs, some hearts in the chat for Jon? Jon, we got a lot of folks on right now watching you, and we're excited to have you on. Would you mind? My brother has a. We're gonna read a little bit of your bio. Is that all right? We'd like to.
That sounds good.
Introduce the gang.
Go for
okay.
it.
Okay, we are so excited to have Jon Stebbins here. Jon Stebbins is a Los Osos, California-based musician, songwriter, documentary producer, and author of 4 books about the Beach Boys, as well as 2 other books. He was a member of a music band called The Point, which was active on on the Los Angeles club circuit from 1979 to 1985.
Cool.
The Point were often described as part of LA's psychedelic revival scene known as the Paisley Underground. They released a self-titled tour, a 4-song EP in 1981 that was described by the LA Times as having a purity of intent that recalls the haunting residents of pre-psychedelic Northern California groups like the Beau Brummels. That sounds awesome.
Nice.
The Point released a full-length album in 1983 called Magic Circle. The record was produced by Vitus Matari of the Last and recorded at Radio Tokyo Studio in Venice, California, and released on the Wharf Rat label. Magic Circle was also released in Europe in 1984 on the Lolita label. One of its songs, All My Life, which was co-written by Jon and Point co-founder Tom Alford, was included in a 2006 episode of the Gilmore Girls television show.
Nice. Love that show. Well, my sisters love that show. I so much love that.
Stebbins and his former Point bandmate Tom Alford resumed their songwriting partnership in 2020. That year, Alford recorded and released the Alford Stebbins composition Moving Into Love, which received international airplay. Stebbins currently plays guitar as Jay Uno in the Atascadero, California-based freeform psychedelic band Juno Tuesday. Stebbins' first book on the subject of the Beach Boys, drummer Dennis Wilson, is titled Dennis Wilson, The Real Beach Boy. In 2007, Virgin Books London published The Lost Beach Boy, which Stebbins wrote with David Marks, one of the early members of the Beach Boys. Stebbins has also written The Beach Boys, Frequently Asked Questions, All That's Left to Know About America's Band, an extensive reference style book for Backbeat Books, which was published in September 2011. Stebbins' fourth book on the Beach Boys was published in June 2013 by Backbeat Books. It was co-written with Ian Rustin. The book is titled The Beach Boys in Concert, The Complete History of America's Band on Tour and on Stage. We're actually going to give away a copy of that tonight.
Yeah. Yeah.
In October 2012, Stebbins' first non-Beach Boy book was published, titled It Happened at Chez J's, chronicling the history of a legendary Santa Monica restaurant and bar and the colorful life of its Playboy owner, Jay Fiondella. Stebbins is currently writing the 75-year-plus history of Universal Attractions Agency, a New York-based booking agency founded in 1945, wow, which is still in operation. The book is scheduled to be published in 2022. He also contributed liner notes and project research to the 2008 Legacy Edition CD release of Dennis Wilson's Pacific Ocean Blue, which we know a lot of folks on here love that album, which was Rolling Stone Magazine's 2008 reissue of the year. He has also worked as a producer and creative contributor to television shows airing on the BBC, including the documentaries The Beach Boys, Wouldn't It Be Nice, and Queen, Days of Our Lives, as well as two multi-episode series, The Secret Map Hollywood and I'm in a Rock and Roll Band. Stebbins is also co-producer of the 2010 BBC television documentary Legends, Dennis Wilson, The Real Beach Boy. That is awesome, by the way. If you haven't seen that, I'm going to post really a link to that later. I love that. It was also nominated for a Royal Television Society Award as Best Documentary. And he's also been an interview subject on the show Autopsy, The Last Hours of Dennis Wilson, and Breaking the Band. He is a contributor and interview subject in the 2019 documentary Manson, Music from an Unsound Mind. Wow, what a resume. We're so excited.
How did I have
time
for all that?
I know.
And still look like this.
Yeah. You do.
Well, we're really happy that you decided to come on the show and speak with us tonight.
Thank you.
We're honored, John.
Thank you for being here.
Thank you. It's nice to hear all that reeled back at me.
So. Yeah. Yeah, exactly. John, do you mind? All of our honored guests, we kind of asked two kind of obligatory questions, and they're pretty basic.
Okay.
But we'd like to ask them for you. Number one, what is your favorite Beach Boy album? Favorite Beach Boy album?
That's rough.
I know. It's
Yeah. That's really rough. It changes all the time.
Sure.
I just listened to Holland yesterday and was just blown away by the eclectic nature of Holland. It's a album that's really mellow, laid back, but it has like narration in places, and then it has really strange things happening, like a steamboat. Really impressive. And then the fairy tale is just, completely off the rails kind of weirdness. But
that's right.
So that was my favorite Beach Boys album yesterday.
I love it.
I would say probably overall Sunflower is one that I can't ever argue with. There was a time where I was really into 2020. I know you guys just did a show on 2020, and back then when I first discovered it, it was probably early to mid 70s. I had no concept that it was a compilation album. If it was bits pulled from here and there, I thought it was an actual, release that they was organically created and they wanted to put out at that time. So that was my perception of it until I learned more. It's funny that once you learn that was kind of a pastiche of singles and B-sides and things that were left over, it kind of seemed to like diminish my enjoyment of it a little bit almost. Yeah. So, but yeah, I would say 2020, Sunflower, that era into Holland. That's all my favorite. And then of course All Summer Long. So, now I got five favorite number one Beach Boys albums.
That's okay.
All Summer Long, to me, it's just the quintessential Beach Boys album, really. It has such a charm to it, but in the context of the time, because that album I actually experienced as it came out as a really young person, 6 years old or 7 years old. My sisters were teenagers and they brought it home and it was just playing in our house all the time. So summer into fall of 64, I experienced All Summer Long, and it's in my DNA.
That's
album.
Cool.
Wow.
Yeah, that is really
great.
I loved your take on 2020. Matt, I changed my mind back. I like 2020. It's good stuff.
Well, right. John, it's funny you mentioned that, because that when we did the episode last week, that was kind of my issue with it, is that I almost don't consider it like an album. It's almost like a greatest hits album or something, you know, or rarities or something, you know. So
which it really is. I mean, it really is. But again, you know, when you don't really perceive it as, you know, as that, and it's just hit you all at once, it's there's an amazing amount of talent and depth to that album. It's just it's really beautiful in so many ways.
Yeah,
no doubt.
How about and I'm sure your answer is going to be similar in terms of, you know, you probably have a lot of different answers at different days. Favorite Beach Boys song? How about that?
Yeah. Again, really rough for somebody like me. Wow, Kiss Me Baby,
awesome answer.
Just makes the hair on my neck stand up. Something about it that can make me cry. That song.
Yeah.
I think. You know, there's several tracks on Pet Sounds as well, but I think I'll go with Kiss Me Baby at this point. Yeah,
okay,
it's my favorite song.
I love it. So, John, I think the way we talked about this a little bit, I think, in communicating, but if it's okay, I think we'll ask you some questions that we want to get out, because we have a bunch of questions.
Yeah,
but then
go
I thought
for it.
You shared with us a ton of incredible pictures, and I was hoping that would it be okay if maybe we show the picture and you maybe give us a little bit?
Sure. I have so many more. That it felt, you know, I started looking through things today and it was just like, oh my God, where do I start? So I just tried to send you guys some things that were kind of relevant to me.
I love it.
Cause I'm in a lot of them, or there's some thing about them that had meaning to me, but sure. Go ahead.
Yeah. We've never done like an interview through pictures before. I think that's a really, really fun idea. So, well, first, can you talk us through, you know, how did you become a Beach Boy fan? It sounds like you became a Beach Boy fan really early on. Can you talk us through that
sister,
a little bit?
My oldest sister, Carla, who's about 10 years older than me, brought home the Free Will and Bob Dylan album and the Surfin' USA album on the same day.
Okay.
So I had, you know, I had exposure as, I think at that point I'm 5 years old. I had exposure to those two albums like simultaneously.
Wow.
And I remember like, you know, looking at these album covers and just kind of downloading the whole vibe of those things. My dog is talking, so he may talk. He's laying right next to me.
Awesome.
But the Surfin' USA album was huge for me. It's the album that made me want to learn how to play the guitar. You know, that whole kind of muted, you know, chord sound that they use, that real surf guitar sound on that album was hugely influential to me. And I had to learn how to do that. You know, so by the time I was 9 or 10, I was, you know, playing the guitar and still, you know, being influenced by that album. So that's kind of how I became a Beach Boys fan. In kind of real time, I remember Surfing Safari, Surfing USA, you know, and I Get Around was just like a massive hit on the radio all the time.
Yeah.
When I was growing up, and kids in my neighborhood had Beach Boys albums. You know, I remember the neighbors had the first album. We didn't have that. We had Surfing USA. And then we had the concert album. All Summer Long and the concert album were really huge. So, you know, those first few years of the Beach Boys, you know, it's just like the kids in my neighborhood were Beach Boys fans, and I was one of them. As a 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 year old,
that's pretty amazing to kind of experience those things as they're happening. It's such an odd thing to think about.
It cuts both ways though, because you guys are really young, and there's a lot of really young Beach Boys fans in the fan base, which is fantastic. But old guys like me, and there's older guys like somebody like Fred Vail, who was actually experiencing these things firsthand. Kind of just experienced them as a consumer. But the thing is there's this contextual issue where everybody's context is different. So, you know, when you have OCD or you're obsessive about facts and things like that, sometimes you're hearing people's opinions, things that are completely out of context to me.
Yeah.
Right.
So yeah, it was great. It's really great. But on the other hand, it kind of turns you into a grumpy old man sometimes.
Well, don't
all that content.
Well, don't watch our show. Don't listen to the things we say. Most of it's not.
Love that you guys just like throw your opinions out there, and you're passionate about them, yeah. and you really talk about the details. You dig into the minutia of it, which is what I love.
Yeah.
So I'm digging it.
Well, it was a really neat point. You said, you kind of the consumer side, right? Fred Vail experience that you went and had the consumer. But when did the consumer turn into writer, author, and digging deep? Because some of these pictures, you're with Brian, you're with David, you're with all.
Yeah. So the transition would be me becoming a musician on my own. And I grew up in Northern California, kind of suburbia, a town called Livermore.
Yeah.
And then a bunch of my friends and I from that town moved to LA and started a band called The Point, which you guys read in my bio.
Yeah.
And we went at it pretty hard for a few years there and did pretty well. We did okay. I guess it was relatively short-lived compared to something like the Beach Boys, and relatively unsuccessful, right, Ozzy? My dog. Anyway, I worked for a record label, Rhino Records. They had affiliation with the Beach Boys. I think the Honeys were on that label at the time. People would come into the warehouse. And since I'm this big fan, I'm meeting, people like Marilyn Wilson. I met her way back then.
Wow.
And I also met Dennis that summer of 78, or the fall of 78, when we first moved to LA to do our band thing. Mm-hmm. So that was, my first firsthand meetings with them. I also met Brian. You could kind of run it, living on the west side of LA, you might just run into the Beach Boys at
Crazy.
That time.
Wow.
I mean, I literally ran into Mike Love, like 3 blocks from my house.
Awesome.
And my girlfriend at the time was like, oh my God, it's Mike Love, And it's like, oh yeah, it's Mike. He's getting out of a car. But I actually got to meet and talk to Dennis, which was really, cool. It was huge for me because I was such a big fan of the Pacific Ocean Blue. I used to keep sealed copies of that record and give it to people because I was such an advocate for that. That's really the direction I wanted the band to go in. It felt like the right extension from Holland to me, the 15 Big Ones. Felt like a step back to me, so I was a big fan of Pacific Ocean Blue. I could tell you the story about hearing it for the first time.
Oh, I love that.
I was in my hometown of Livermore, and I'd been out carousing with some friends or whatever, and crashing on a friend's couch, and I just had the radio on, and there was one of those late night radio shows that did album premieres. And so this record came on, and I didn't hear who it was. Mm-hmm. But, I hear River Song, and it's just like, wow, that's majestic. That's wild. It's like the drums sound like Zeppelin, but the vocals sound like, the backing vocals sound, like this almost glorified Beach Boys kind of feel to it. And then What's Wrong, and his gruff voice and all that. And I'm thinking, is this a new Springsteen album? Listening to this kind of specter.
Yeah.
Production with the rough vocals on it, and it reminded me of Born to Run a little bit. And so I'm thinking halfway into this that maybe I'm hearing the new Springsteen album. And then the break, while the DJ has to turn the record over, like back then, he mentions this is the new solo album by the Beach Boys drummer Dennis Wilson. And I was just like, oh my freaking God, this is Lord. Like the coolest thing I've ever heard, just magical to me. So, so that was my first listen to Pacific Ocean Blue.
Wow.
And the band thing, I went through my band years and kind of transition. Nadia and I got married and we had some kids, and I had a little collectibles business, really into record collecting and stuff. You guys can kind of see my racks back there.
That's awesome.
And I did mail order and things like that, and worked in record stores, and also kept kind of doing some music stuff on the side. But once in a while I'd write a record review, mm-hmm. or some little blurb for one of the local papers, or I think I did some stuff for like Goldmine and Discoveries, which were like the collectible publications for the record collectors and things. And every time I did that, people would tell me, man, you're such a good writer. You should really like write more. You should write a book. And I started thinking about writing a book. And, you know, who is I going to write about? You know, who could hold my interest past, you know, the 2 pages of outline or whatever.
Right.
And, you know, I thought about John Lennon, but there's a million books. I thought about Brian Jones, but I don't really understand his background, because he grew up in Cheltenham, you know.
Right.
I grew up in California, so.
Right.
Dennis Wilson had a very similar kind of suburban California. You know, in my culture, we cruised and we had fast cars and all that stuff. So
yeah.
I kind of understood where Dennis was coming from. And it was kind of natural for me. So I started thinking about, well, there really hasn't been a book about Dennis, and he's really, really interesting character. So I took a shot, started writing. I really got deeply into it. I had a lot of support from some good friends. And, you know, within a couple of years, that book happened. And that book turned out to be really, really successful. Yeah. And I had a lot of help from my buddy Ed Roach, who he said is watching tonight.
Yeah.
He took the photograph that's on the cover, and he kind of, I think the way I described it was he was like a window or a door back to Dennis for me, you know, back, because Dennis was gone by that time. And even though I had met him, it was pretty brief. But Ed gave me a lot of, you know, just crucial kind of, almost like just the vibe of Dennis. Like, what was it? You know, I hung out with Ed a lot, which is an experience in itself. And it gave me a lot of the vibe of what it was like to be around Dennis and all that stuff, not to mention all the materials and the photographs and the videos and footage and, you know, let me view all that stuff. So I really got to soak it all in. And then I wrote a draft, and when he read it, he liked it. I knew I was on the right track. And then I had other people like James Garcia, who also told me I was on the right track.
Yeah.
And Karen Lamb, who was still alive back then, also told me I was on the right track. So I had a lot of support from a lot of great people. Alan Boyd helped me a lot by sharing materials with me. And there was a guy named Chuck Harder who was a big advocate and helped to me at that time. So that, you know, that book was 42 by the time that book came out. It wasn't like I was a young guy, but that led to all the other books.
Yeah.
Well, it's great. And I had a question regarding the Dennis Wilson book. Well, kind of about the book, but you wrote a book about Dennis. As far as I know, it's the definitive one. There might be another one, but it's great. But it got me thinking, you know, I love Brian Wilson, you know, but he has, you know, the Beach Boys story seems to always be centered around Brian and his relationship with his father, you know, and then the mental illness. But it seems like Dennis had a lot of stuff going on too. My first question is, it seems that he gets overlooked in the history of the Beach Boys with that regard. So my first question is, do you agree with that? And if so, why do you think that is?
Well, it really was the case at that time back then. That's a great question. And I'm going to get my dog's bone so he starts biting my hand. I'll be right back.
Okay.
Oh, yeah. No worries. Yeah.
Yeah. Do you see the poster in the background there? If you could see it, that's the Tulane blacktop movie poster. That is sweet. Yeah.
Man, I bet his pad is just full of awesome stuff.
Have you ever seen that movie, Greg?
No, I haven't. Is it any good?
I've never seen it. I want to check it out sometime. But
has anybody in the chat seen that movie? Maybe.
All right.
Okay.
Yeah, great question. That was one of the motivations for writing that book.
Yeah.
Is that I felt like he had been, you know, I kept hearing and seeing Beach Boys evaluations or whatever. that would refer to Dennis as the least talented of the Beach Boys. Mm-hmm. And that, you know, it is not the case. You know, he was had a different kind of talent than the other ones, but he was really talented. And, yeah. You know, just had a huge amount of artistic depth to that guy, even though he was this crazy personality, wild guy. But yeah, I mean, I agree with you that at times he seems to get overlooked somehow in a way, or, and it, you know, he doesn't have the smooth voice that the others had. Mm-hmm. But if you listen to something like Wouldn't It Be Like Nice to Live Again, listen to the vocal on that. He had an amazing voice for a period of time. Very similar to Carl in ways, you know. But yeah, I mean, just Dennis is almost like a solo artist within the Beach Boys, and he's almost like a different character within the Beach Boys as well. Than, you know, his persona was more kind of like a biker, rock and roll, crazy. You know, it's almost like he would fit in better in a harder rock band than the Beach Boys really turned out to be.
Yeah.
So it's a little bit of a square peg situation. But on the other hand, you could say he was the muse, you know. Mm-hmm. He was the quintessential Beach Boy in a lot of ways, you know, especially as a young man. So anyway, follow up.
And he had a lot of, maybe you could talk about a little bit just the, you know, his complicated relationship with his father, because I think that probably pushed him and his, you know, his adult life as well, you know. And again, we hear a lot about Brian's relationship, but I think Dennis's in a way may have been worse, you know. But
yeah, he was tortured.
Yeah,
you know, he's a tortured person. It's really evident. I never met Murray. I know Murray was essential in so many things about the Beach Boys. And I think one of the reasons that they worked so hard on their vocal arrangements and mm-hmm. that type of thing mm-hmm. was to please their parents, was to please Murray. I think that's part of, you know, part of why they turned out to be the way they did. But yeah, there are some things, some stories, you know, I've heard some things maybe that are painful to repeat, mm-hmm. knowing that certain ears and eyes are watching this.
Yeah.
But you could probably tap into some of that in the book.
Yeah.
I guess one of the things is Dennis used to tell people that his earliest memory was getting hit, you know, like full on, like smacked by his father, you know, like with a fist. It's like one of his earliest memories that he would tell people about. So whether that's completely true, I don't know, but it's there. You know, many people told me that, like mm-hmm. he had memories of being, getting the crap beat out of him by his dad as a little kid.
Yes.
Yeah. That's so rough. So rough. Yeah. Yeah. Well, hey, can we pull up a couple? Maybe we'll go back and forth maybe a little bit. So
yeah, we don't want to cry. Let's get happy.
Yeah, no, yeah, let's shift a little bit. So I'm gonna pull up a picture now. John, are you able to? Do you have the stream pulled up anywhere around you?
I do.
Oh, perfect. Okay, so I'm going to go ahead and, folks, John was generous enough to share some really, really awesome pictures with us.
Pretty incredible. Yeah.
Yeah. And so, John, I just pulled it up now. You should see it in just a few seconds here. But the first picture I have up here, and this is in no order, it's just kind of free. We're going to let you kind of give us a little bit about each picture. So here we have you with Brian.
Ed Roach will recognize that photo because he took it.
Cool.
And I'm wearing his shirt, by the way. Yeah, that was
like a shirt.
Brian was playing at the Wiltern in 99. And he was playing somewhere in Southern California the next night. So Ed and I, and I'm writing the Dennis Wilson book around this time. So we went on a multi-day journey of craziness, Ed and I. And I think this was the first night. and we were backstage. Yeah. And I got to sit on the couch and talk to Brian a little bit. And so that's 1999. I had met Brian before that, like back in the 80s, in the early 80s, maybe even 79 or 80. Mm-hmm. But, you know, at this point, I'm walking in there with Ed Roach, who's like somebody that Brian really knew. And it was easier to be able to sit and have a little bit of a talk with him. And I got to shake his hand and tell him what a big influence on me he was. And Ed got the shot.
Awesome.
It's really neat. Was he much different when you met him in the late 70s and then when you met him again in the late 90s?
He seemed more nervous to be meeting me than I was to be meeting him, and I was completely nervous to be meeting him, you know? So yeah. it's a weird thing. It's like I can tell I'm making him nervous.
Interesting.
I'm already nervous, you know.
Yeah.
And that was the case in 79 or 80 the first time. When I met him, and then this time, this was pretty cool. This is, he had just put on a great show and he seemed pretty happy. But I would say I've been in lucky, really blessed to have been around Brian maybe 15 times in my life where I've gotten to talk to him.
Wow.
And a couple of times it was just me and Brian and maybe one other person. Mm-hmm. Which is really when you really see the real Brian. So say out of those 15 times, mm-hmm. maybe 13 of them, he was pretty uncomfortable. But but there were a couple of times where I was around Brian where you'd see the kind of the leader guy come out. Mm. You know the dynamic sort of telling people what the deal is and what to do, and he's confident and funny. I've seen that side of him as well.
Wow.
They did a thing on the Capitol Records rooftop in like 2005 maybe,
mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
where they got the Platinum Award for Sounds of Summer, and I got to go up to that. And it's just press the Beach Boys and some Capitol execs. So there wasn't a lot of people, mm-hmm. maybe like 40 people up there.
Mm-hmm.
And that day, man, Brian was just firing on all cylinders. Mm-hmm. He was the funniest guy. He was super confident. And it's all, you know, I had seen him enough times before that where he's kind of nervous and one word answers to everything. So it was really like, wow, there's the guy who, you know, the Pet Sounds guy, you know, there's the guy who's telling all the musicians what to do. And, you know, all of, because, you know, you see that footage of him from that period and he's very dynamic. Well, I think that guy's still in there, you know, it's just, he doesn't let him out all the time, but I've seen it a couple times actually. I got to go, he played in my area, I don't know, must be 5 or 6 years ago now. It could be even longer, the way time goes by. Maybe it's more like 10 years ago. But and at that show, I had a smile. I had a smile slick that had all the Beach Boys signatures on it, except for Brian's. It even had Dennis's on it.
Oh, wow.
And I told Darian, hey, I've got this thing that the fan from Australia had sent it to me and said, you know, if you ever see Brian, if you could just get him to add his signature to this. And so I told Darian about it. Darian came out and got me and took me back before the show and it was just like Brian and me and Darian basically in that room, maybe one other person. And Darian was really nice and said, look, this is John. He wrote a book about your brother. You know, and he brought this smile thing, and it's like it's got everybody's signature on it except for yours. And so he's like, wow, he was looking at it, and then he like went to sign it. He almost signed like right over Carl's name. And Darian's like, no, like right up here, you know.
Yeah.
But that was another time where he was, you know, he was asking me like, do you have your family with you? You know, who'd you come here with? And it was just really regular. Person nice, wasn't uncomfortable, so that was cool.
I love that.
That's awesome.
By the way, real quick, want to give a shout out to Clean Man 93, welcome back, Retro Smokey 88 Streams, Nanki, Paul, welcome everybody. Once again, we have amazing author, musician, writer, Jon Stebbins here with us. We're going through some pictures that he sent us, and we thought it'd be a fun way to kind of talk through the interview. So
maybe I can get shorter answers now.
No, these are great. Hey, this is
these are great. Awesome.
Yeah, let's move on to the next picture here. Now, this is an interesting one. I don't know if you see it yet, but it looks like a Brother Studio tape of what is to become Pacific Ocean Blue there. Can you maybe talk us through a little bit of that? Oh, maybe you don't see
it. Yeah, that's a pre-release a pre-release copy of Pacific Ocean Blue that was given to me by a fellow fan.
Wow.
It's got the Brother Studio paper label pasted on it. Mm-hmm. And if you check the date out, is it March or is it May?
May 26th of 2017.
It's May. So the album didn't come out till the end of September or the end of August. So that's quite a ways before the record came out. If you notice, the River song is just called River. When I first got it, I was like, oh wow, it's going to have different mixes or whatever. But it's the exact album.
Wow.
To the year. Maybe if Alan Boyd heard it, he would hear some different EQing or something on it.
Right,
but
right.
For me, it sounds pretty much like the record. There is not any other, there's not any strange edits or anything on there. So that made me a little sad, actually.
Okay, why is that?
Because he had that record ready to go in May, and he had to hold it back. Now, you know, I'm a fan of Beach Boys' Love You, mm-hmm. as well. Mm-hmm. It's wonderful and its quirkiness and all that. But Dennis had been knocking his brains out on this album for years, and he had it ready to go, and he had to hold it back for months so that it didn't come out in the same time period as Beach Boys Love You. Oh. And I think he deferred to his brother on that. I really do.
That seems to be a really a common theme, right? The brothers were pretty all selfless to each other. I mean, Brian to Carl and Carl to Dennis and Dennis to Carl.
But there are outtakes and different edits and takes of the Pacific Ocean Blue material. Mm-hmm. I was really surprised to hear that when we worked on the Legacy Edition box set back in 2007 or so. I got to hear a bunch of stuff. Like rainbows, hearing rainbows with extra verses and it's the exact take that ends up on the record, but the take on the record is edited. So there's a longer tag on it. There's another verse in it, you know, things like that exist.
Yeah.
And there's actually a lot of unreleased Dennis Wilson stuff that's still hasn't seen the light of day from that period.
Really?
We had talked about maybe a third, you know, because Bamboo came out, the Bamboo material, and the third album I think was going to be called Tornado. So it was going to be Pacific Ocean Blue, Bamboo, and then Tornado.
Cool.
And Tornado, I discussed it with Jim Guercio and people like that, about maybe crafting something and putting out sort of the third, because when Dennis signed to CBS or to Caribou, mm-hmm. he signed a 3-album deal.
Oh, okay.
So I did not know that.
Yeah, I didn't know that either.
Yeah, it was supposed to be 3 albums. So it was going to be Pacific Ocean Blue, Bamboo. He got a little way, you know, he got pretty far into Bamboo. It was pretty much done. All it needed to be done was pulled together and mm-hmm. mixed and produced, mm-hmm. and then Tornado. So
man, I had no idea about
there's
that.
There's enough left over.
I'm sorry. Yeah, you're saying that there is music from that Tornado era that hasn't been released yet?
Yeah, it's all kind of the same era because he never stopped recording.
Right.
Oh, okay. I see.
You know, he was just working in the studio. And once, you know, he was done with something, he just kind of let other people mix it or put it together or edit it. He was not... Like, isn't Brian kind of that way too? Generally,
he's not
really into finishing things.
Right.
Yeah,
kind of moves on.
Right. Yeah.
Do you think there's ever going to be a chance that music comes out?
I do. Yeah.
Very good.
Hey, John.
I think there's people that want to see that happen.
Yeah.
Oh, I think we'd all love that. Hey, real quick, just a side question to that picture. What's your most valuable piece of, do you have, collect memorabilia? Do you have a most valued thing that, man, if your house is on fire, you're going to grab that and run out of the house?
Valued. Yeah. Well, gee. Yeah. I don't know. There's too much of it, really. Mm-hmm. I do have one really cool thing I'm going to just grab.
Okay.
Greg, I had no idea he was going to have a third album. That's
Tornado. What a killer name, too.
I had never heard that before.
It might not mean anything, you know, value-wise, but this is this was on the wall in the Wilson's music room at one time.
So, no way.
Yeah, this is a larger print than we would ever see of this. And it's, I don't know if you guys can see the resolution on it, but it's really amazing.
Real sharp. Yeah.
And so the story is that Joanne Marks and Murray like got into it. David's mom got into it over David. Mm-hmm. And there's a whole backstory to that, because really it was more, you know, we always hear about Murray sort of baiting David into quitting, and then David quit and whatnot. But there's a period in there where things are tanking between Murray and David's parents, because David's mom didn't get along and she wanted to have more control over mm-hmm. management issues and things mm-hmm. like that. Mm-hmm. So anyway, she tore this off the wall in the Wilson's music room. And on the back of it, it has all of the, I don't know if you can see, there's
some writing.
You see some writing back there?
Yeah.
Yeah.
So it's in her writing, like basically her concept of what David was going to do now. And it's just like a blow by blow of what he was going to do. It mentions Russ Reagan in here. So you guys know that name?
I don't. No, I don't.
Yeah.
Russ Reagan is the guy who basically named the Beach Boys the Beach Boys.
Oh, okay.
Oh, yeah. So
you know
that. Okay.
You know the story. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. So Russ Reagan was like a, I guess kind of like an A&R guy or something. They were going to be the Surfers or the Pendletons, right? Or they didn't, you know. And then he's the one who said, "No, let's call them the Beach Boys." And the Beach Boys didn't even know they were going to be the Beach Boys till they saw those first pressings of
That's right.
Of
yeah, I remember that story. Yeah.
Yeah. So anyway, Russ Reagan is the guy who got Dave and the Marksman signed to A&M. So anyway, back here it talks about, we'll get Russ Reagan to get us signed. And that, I don't know. That's just like almost like Big Bang. It's close to the Big Bang.
That is an incredible piece of history.
A huge piece of history.
Oh my gosh.
Yeah. Wow.
That's fantastic.
I don't know. I really like that one, but I probably have some things that are more valuable, you know, money wise. But
man, well, this
just
yeah.
just I just have the records, and I do have a few I have some unreleased things and mm-hmm. things people have given me that are, you know, I've got interviews, you know, that have people telling me things that I could never. That I could never repeat, you know. Yeah. So,
well, this next picture, John, that just has come up, I think is perfectly timed. We did not I wish I could take credit for this, but it looks like you're on a couch with the one and only David Marks, and you guys are playing some guitar. What's going on here?
That's right. He's come to visit me. We became really good friends. So mm-hmm. it's just, you know, I'm a Beach Boys fan big time and all of that, but we kind of go beyond Beach Boys, our friendship. It's just, we're just friends and that's buddies cool. and we hang out. He's even helped me move.
Really?
That's when you know he's a good friend.
That's awesome.
He helped me move, carry boxes, you know, from one house to the other.
Wow.
That was a mind blower, because Al called him that day. So Al called him on my phone. So I got Al on my, you know, caller ID. Hello, is Dave there? Yeah, he's moving one of my boxes into my new house, and so then those guys are talking. So yeah, my relationship with David is very casual, and one of the things that's really cool is that whenever we get together, we just kind of play you know, we have guitars sitting around. He's got 18 guitars. I have one, but we, you know, we play guitars and talk about music. And I can tell you, his recall of those, just the way that the Beach Boys played on those early records, the way Carl and he played on those early records, mm-hmm. is really cool, because it's just so authentic. So I'm playing in my room, you know, and he's like, no, we played it like this. And then he does cool. it differently. Well. And then it's just like, oh, right. it sounds just like the record. You guys ever heard that, the bootleg recording of them in Australia in 64, where they're doing, I think they're doing What I Say.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. It's a radio thing, isn't it?
So So we were talking about Ray Charles or something, and I'm sitting there, and he goes, "Oh yeah, we used to do a Ray Charles song," and he starts playing that whatever, that little two fingered, you know, do, do,
do, do, do, yeah, that's do, right, right.
And it's just like, I'm just, my mind goes, it sounds just like the record, doesn't it?
Ozzy knows,
and hey. You know, he wasn't even in the band at that time, so you know, yeah. that just shows you
wow
that he and Carl were working out all that stuff, you know.
Hey John, I had a question. That's cool. A friend of ours asked me to ask you this, because you wrote a book with David Marks. They were wondering if you were thinking about with David doing maybe a follow-up, because since you've written that book, I believe, you know, so much more has happened with David, right? So he probably has a lot more to tell. So they were just wondering about that.
Yeah, we've talked about it. You know, it was kind of in the works for a little while, and then progress yeah. stalled. Not for any other reason except that we're just distracted with our life and our families and things. But
right.
I was just with David a few weeks ago, and I started doing like taped interviews with him again, because he was just like rolling out stories that I had never heard. And I'm like, why didn't you tell me that back in 2006 when I could have used it in the book? You yeah. know? Because he's rolling out stories from the early days, but you're right. It so much did happen, because that book ends with the monument, mm-hmm. when the Beach Boys monument was dedicated. Right. So that's 04, I think.
Yeah, the whole 50th anniversary, you know, and yeah. coming back. Yeah. And Greg and I were able to see one of those shows, and it was really neat to see David Marks out there playing all that surf guitar. You know, it was really cool. Yeah, so, really
where did you guys see the?
We saw them in Cincinnati. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. And were they good that night?
They were great. Yeah, they were amazing.
Yeah. Although it's hard. It's hard. You know, we're getting excited. You know,
they had great chemistry on that tour.
Yeah.
I mean, they really had a lot of fun with each other.
Yeah.
And it took the whole thing to a higher level. Like the venues they were playing were bigger, the press was paying attention to them more. Mm-hmm. It was really cool to see, and there's a completeness to it. Obviously it's never the same without Carl or Dennis, to me. Right. It could never be the same, but it was the closest thing we could get at the time. Right. And I heard you guys talking about, you know, whether anything for the 60th is gonna happen, and well, you know, all I can say is that back at that time, when the 50th was percolating, stuff was changing right up to the last second. I mean, really, literally right up to the last second. Mm. So it wasn't like there was this concept that they all signed off on and agreed to. Mm-hmm. You know, it's just the way it happened is they did the thing on the Grammys. The television broadcast of the Grammys, and that got you know, noticed and kind of raised their profile, and then the 50th thing just kind of opened up to them all, you know, all of the dates and whatnot. So I would say the answer to the question you guys wanted to ask me, do I know anything? I've heard
it was coming.
I've heard some things from the inside.
Wow.
And you know, they're talking about doing something.
Okay.
And you know, you had said it's never going to be 75 day tour like that. Yeah. And you're definitely right about that.
Yeah.
But
okay.
But they want to do something.
Yeah.
And it's being, I can't say anymore. I'll get killed.
Okay. Yeah, that's okay.
We want to keep you safe. We're good.
Yeah. They want to do something. They want to do something. And what I've heard as the concept seems kind of appropriate to me. So let's see, it's just a matter of whether there's so many personalities and business people involved wives and all that stuff. So
John, are you going to be upset if tomorrow morning we post a video and just a clip of you saying that and the headline reads 60th reunion tour confirmed Jon Stebbins, and then we put it everywhere to support the show? You're okay with that?
Yeah,
right?
I can think of a couple people who would really hate me.
we won't do that. Hey, John, can we do this again? Because we still have time, but I have so many things I want to ask you, and I don't want to waste your time. But man, is there a book? No, never mind. I want to go back to the picture with David, you playing guitar. When you guys get together and you guys are playing guitar with each other, you're both awesome musicians, you're both great guitar players. What is like the first tune you guys start picking out? What does he start playing? What do you start playing?
Oh, it's like Chuck Berry stuff, that kind of thing. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. But I like the I think I'd mentioned before, you know, like the muted guitar sound that's on like Farmer's Daughter.
That
kind of stuff, or like their take of Miserloo, that kind of thing. I mean, I really love that sort of thing. And Dave likes how I play that, because he's told me, like, you're one of the only people that really figured out how, how we did that. Yeah. And so, that feels good, but he's a real musician. I'm just, I'm self-taught. He's beyond what you guys probably know. Most Beach Boys fans would know. I mean, he can play a classical, he can play jazz. He's trained with masters. He was a student at Berklee School of Music. After the Beach Boys, he trained with Vicente Gomez, classical, and then he's played with, all kinds of.
Man, it kind of
great,
makes you wonder why the kind of reunion with him didn't happen sooner, because they were bringing so many great musicians in the band. Heck, he would have.
He has his issues,
Yeah.
You can read the book, and there were times where he had health issues. He has health issues right now. Mm-hmm. And there's times where he had substance issues and all that kind of thing. And he really didn't like the Beach Boys. I sort of had to reintroduce him to the Beach Boys. He wanted to just leave all that in the past. He wanted to do sessions for blues guitar, blues bands and hybrid jazz blues bands and things like that. And he didn't really. He'll admit this. Like when he went back in '98 and was in the band in '98, yeah, after Carl passed, he had to learn all those Pet Sounds songs that they were doing, right. He had to learn Wouldn't It Be Nice, he had to learn God Only Knows, or whatever, maybe they weren't doing God Only Knows, but now they do, and he had to learn it for the 50th. And by learning those songs, he realized, he knew Brian was a genius, but it confirmed to him, wow, Brian is like beyond. He watched Brian more as a vocal arranger in his young life, and he knew Brian had an incredible ear for vocal arranging. But as far as Brian being able to put those tracks together like he did later, David didn't really understand that until he had to go back and learn it all. Him leaving the Beach Boys was kind of as a 15-year-old, if you guys can, it was traumatic, because it's not just him, and he's breaking up with his best friends, and his family is at odds with them. There's a whole emotional element that just made him want to just turn that page.
Of course.
And it's one of the reasons why he got written out of their story so successfully, which, you know, to me it was just like, there's so many Beach Boys books that get their early history wrong.
Yeah.
Because
yeah,
you know, and I'm not trying to diminish Al in any way. Al mm-hmm. is wonderful and great, and he's definitely, you know, he definitely helped create that band.
Yeah.
But they didn't really become the Beach Boys that you hear on Surfing USA. And when they went from being a local act to being a nationally successful act, that was David, you know, David's band. David, I mean, not, it's always Brian's band, but what I'm saying is that, you know, David and Carl sort of pushed that guitar sound into the forefront of the band. Mm. If the Surfing USA album is basically what their live set was around that time.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And it's really guitar,
it's all guitars,
centric.
Yeah.
And
that's David's a really big part of that. So the way he got kind of, you just kept reading that he was a brief fill-in for Al, because that's kind of how Murray wanted the story to be written once David was gone. He just wanted David, you know, not acknowledged at all. And so they never really did. They you know, they trained themselves, that they had this story, you know, where we all got together and we rented the instruments and Al's mom rented the bass.
Yeah.
And then we became the Beach Boys. Well, yeah, but what about those 2 years when you became famous and successful nationally?
Right.
And then there's the period where there's six Beach Boys. You know, Surfer
right.
Girl, a lot of the tracks on Surfer Girl have six Beach Boys on them.
Mm.
So you've got Al and David both in the band.
Yeah.
And none of the books we read, you know, had, I know I say the words you know a lot, I'm sorry. They keep getting called out on that.
Yeah,
but,
no, you're good.
They just didn't acknowledge that David was part of the you know, the foundation and the, you know, part of the DNA that made the Beach Boys the Beach Boys, because he wasn't really a vocalist and mm-hmm. yada yada, but he owned 20% of the Beach Boys.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
And the way their original contract was structured, that was through 1967. So when they signed with Capitol, basically, David had a 20% share of the Beach Boys through 1967, and he didn't really ever get bought out of that contract. So there's a lot of weird stuff that happened to him as a 15-year-old.
Yeah.
But he just kind of let it happen, and he never fought for himself, like, hey, wait a minute, you know, I was part of that band. He would just rather see it all just go away until we started working on his book in 2005 or 2006.
Yeah.
And we went back in and we really looked at the, you know, about what really, really, really happened. And he was there until November of 63, or October or November of 63. And he was still hanging out with them and, you know, interacting with them. Murray wanted to manage the Marksmen,
mm-hmm.
you know, there's, so it's not like he just came and filled in for Al while Al went off to school. It's,
right.
it's more like they were, here's what I always say. Show me a picture of the Beach Boys before David Marks was in the band.
Yeah. That's a great point.
Dang.
There is not one.
Dang. Yeah. That's a mic drop type situation.
Yeah, man. It is.
That's awesome.
Yeah. So if David's not a founding member of the band, why do no pictures exist
right.
of the band before David?
So John, isn't
because the first thing you do when you form a band, right? I mean, you know, if the dad's the manager, they're going to take pictures, you know? So I kept hearing rumors about somebody's mom had a picture of the Beach Boys. Mark, you know, we call them Beach Boys Mark One.
Mm-hmm.
But never seen it.
Mm.
Doesn't exist.
Yeah.
When they got serious about being a band, and they started promoting themselves. Mm-hmm. David was in the band.
Yeah.
And, you know.
And he, am I wrong? He's not.
And again, I don't want to, I'm not trying to diminish Al. Cause,
yeah, yeah.
You know,
no, of course not.
Al's part of the family. He's part of the, you know, the DNA of the Beach Boys. And his contributions are huge, you know. So I'm just trying to be factual. That's all I've just, you know, if they're important, we should understand them. You know, what really happened with the way that, you know, they were built.
Yeah. Well, yeah.
Absolutely.
Well,
absolutely.
His contributions are equally huge. I mean, like you just said, he's foundational. He's a huge piece to that puzzle. And you wonder what that band looks and sounds like if David wasn't a part. Which was odd because I was at the Rock Hall not too long ago. Am I wrong in saying that his name is not on the? Is he in the Rock Hall with the Beach Boys?
The what?
The Rock and Roll Hall of Fame.
The Rock. No, he didn't get officially inducted. That was just the four, right?
I think Bruce's name is on there, isn't it, Matt?
I think Bruce came later. Not originally, he wasn't. Originally, I think it was the three Wilson brothers and Al, yeah, and Mike. Well, Mike.
So David. The other thing is David never got like gold records for all of those records that he became massive, you know, Surfing USA,
really?
Surfer Girl, Little Deuce Scoop.
No way.
Because by the time they held the ceremonies for those, they're like 64 or 65. So all of those got passed, you know, I don't know who, but I'm not going to say bad things about people.
No, sure, sure.
But David was, he never got any of that stuff, you know. He did later, once they realized, you know, I mean, I'm talking later, like maybe 2005, 2006, 2007. I think Jeffrey Foskett went to Capitol and said, hey, you know, this guy was on all of those things, and he never even got his gold records for them. And they issued him gold records for all of the.
Oh, man, that's an awesome
that
story.
That is awesome.
Yeah.
Jeff Foskett did that.
Anyway, back to your point. I kind of lost it. What was it again?
Oh, well, we were just talking about, and it looks like the chat. See, this is everybody's so much smarter than we are. It looks like David maybe was inducted later. Bruce has not been inducted.
Yeah,
yet,
yeah,
so,
that's
okay.
The story. So,
I got. I'm
so,
sorry. Thank you.
So yeah, when the book came
thanks,
out,
thanks, Patricia.
When the book came out, the Rock Hall found out about it, and they did a really nice David Marks Day, and they bought like 1,000 copies of the book and put it in their gift shop at the Rock Hall, and they had him come do a Q&A and stuff.
Wow, good for him.
And so then if you look in whatever the display that they have of the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame, it includes him. Whether or not he's like considered officially inducted, I don't even know what the criteria is for that or whatever. But the Rock Hall did acknowledge that it was that he had been kind of overlooked and that he should have been inducted with them.
Yeah.
But I don't think Mike has advocated for him occasionally in really nice ways, but I don't know if at that time anybody said, hey, you gotta bring David into this too, I don't think that happened. But it did happen later though, where they insisted that he be included in things. And one of them was that thing on the rooftop,
right,
that I told you about when they gave the Platinum Awards for the Sounds of Summer. Capitol didn't invite him to that. As far as I know, that was the band that said, hey, you know, you should be here for this.
Man, that's cool.
So,
that's great.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, I.
So the reunion had to be, I'm sorry, this. Greg, real quick. The reunion probably had to be kind of healing then for all of them, right? And David, you know, the 50th, to come back and be able to play and.
Oh, you know. Yeah. It was a lot of fun. That was a really good thing. Wish it could have lasted longer. But,
yeah,
you know,
no doubt.
It is what it is.
Yeah.
John, we run out of time here, but I won't put you on the spot. We would kill to have you back because there's like a million. You got to see these pictures. I won't share them with anybody, obviously, but we would
maybe show the one of David as like a 10-year-old.
Yeah, let's see if I can find that one. Let's go through it.
But John, we've heard a lot of comments in the chat too. We'd love you sometime.
Look at all
to come
these
back
awesome
for,
pictures.
For a part two, if you're interested.
I love. By the way, I love this one. I really want to hear the story behind that one. But Let's see if we can find all these pictures are so great. That's an awesome picture too.
They're all
so
awesome.
Good.
Anyway, there's a cool one of him.
I think is it this one right here? He's playing guitar. That is an awesome picture, by the way.
Yeah, that's pretty cool.
Is that the one you're looking for?
Yeah, he's in the house across the street from the Wilsons, right there.
Wow.
Playing his carbon electric. That's the time right there where he and Carl are just starting to get together.
Oh my goodness.
And play guitars together.
How sweet is that?
So I mean, you can think about that. You know, Carl's 2 years older. So what's David look like there? He looks like he's maybe 10 or 11.
Oh my
Carl's
gosh.
Probably like 12 or 13. And they're like, you know, after school, that's what those guys were doing, sitting chairs and playing their guitars together. And that's, you know, that's the chemistry came about, the guitar chemistry came about. That's very vibrant and evident on those early albums. Yeah.
Oh, what a phenomenal
incredible
picture. John, can I
incredible
maybe can we each ask maybe one quick question before we I have one I'd l- I just want to ask you.
And yeah, then, go for and it then, and I will come back.
Oh gosh, we would
so. Awesome.
Love,
that'd be great.
Love that.
You guys just let me know. And
yeah,
we'll, make it work.
We'll have to do a part. We got a ton of people in the chat that are saying please part two because we're not. I feel like we haven't even gotten into this. Okay, John, is there a Beach Boy book that hasn't been written that you think needs or you'd like to write? Maybe not you personally, but is there something out there that should be written about that you think?
I mean, I would love to see a really great Carl Wilson biography.
Yeah,
but, I mean, there was one. You know, and I know the fellow who wrote it.
Is it The Long Promise Road? Was that what it was called?
Maybe he did. You know, he did the best he could. He was more into the Carl, the guitar player, or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I think there's a really honest book to be written, and it's like this thick. And you know, this thick. I mean, it's like you know, it's like. Ridiculously thick book. I don't have the stamina. I'm not the guy. I think I've kind of done what I'm going to do and said what I'm going to say. But I think there's also some documentaries and things like that still to come. So I hope that answers your question.
Yeah. Matt, anything else for John? I'm sure you have a million things, but
I do. I'll finish with this one, John. Just for everybody out there and that'll see this and other people, you've done quite a bit of research on the Beach Boys. I really like this book. I've read through most of it. It's really an amazing book. So thank you for that. And we're going to have Ian on the show, I think, too.
Great.
But what do you think is the lasting? I don't want to be general, I guess, but just if you're talking to somebody who doesn't know the Beach Boys very well, you know, their legacy, their contributions, what's so special about the Beach Boys, you know? You know what I'm asking?
Yeah. It's complex, just like people, like human beings are complex. There's a blissful thing that happens in their music. Where some kind of humanity comes out, and sometimes it's a little bit sad. Yeah. You know, we always hear about the Beach Boys being sunshine and fun and positive and everything, but I think the most beautiful moments in their canon are really kind of a little bit sad. There's a nostalgic quality. There's a little bit of a melancholy thing. So I think it's about emotional depth that happens in their stuff where the humanity somehow sneaks out. I think Brian is a conduit to something spiritual. So it's a spiritual, it's like a spiritual light that somehow emanates from their music and places, and different people find it in different places, but it's really in there.
Great.
I got goosebumps during your answer.
Yeah.
As I'm giving
too.
Your answer, I'm remembering that the Endless Summer or Endless Harmony documentary, and at the very end, it's got the Good Vibrations coda in the background, and Carl was asked kind of that same question, and I think he gives almost an identical answer to you, John. I think that is really because he talks
so
about
I just stole it from
yeah
Carl.
no it's I think it was it's really telling how yeah. connected you are to the music, and I think it says a lot about you. It says a lot about how much time and energy you've given to the group and to us fans, you know, because can you imagine not having any of these books? I mean, we'd still be in the dark on so many things. But yeah, Carl says, you know, I think we talked about the music, the emotional element of the music, the human experience in a really simple way, you know, and he Carl said,
yeah, everybody cool. finds something different in there. Yeah. You know, I can restate that because my perception of what, you know, what's magical for me is different than the next guy. It's like, we don't all find it in the same place. There's a lot of stuff, a lot of different directions. But there's just joy. There's joy to be found in there. And it's not always, sometimes it's joy with a tear, you know?
Sure. Sure.
Yeah.
Well, John, we can't thank you enough. Hey, do us a favor. We have a ton of people on here that have been giving you messages throughout the show, wanting to say, hey, thank you. And we love you. And some really great. So if you get a moment and can go back through and just, you know, read some, a lot of the love for you out there. Cause you got a lot of fans watching you tonight and
thank you.
A lot of really wonderful things being said. but we can't thank you enough for joining us. We're humbled. And as always, can't believe you came to talk to us and all of our friends here. So thank you. Thank you very much.
Thanks for having me. And just let me know and we'll do this some more. We'll expand on what we talked about tonight.
We would love it.
Can't wait. Thank you, John.
All right, John. Hey, you take care now. Bye-bye.
Take care. Bye.
Bye. All right. All right. Wow.
No, stop it. Okay, never mind. How do I cancel that? Okay. That was awesome. Man, I feel like I say that after all of our interviews, but that was really so insightful. I loved it.
It really was. Yeah. So many different layers of things he said. I really need to get that David Marks book. I think he's right about
too.
That.
I'm embarrassed we don't have that.
Kind of forgotten about. I'm going to get that. Loved his comments on Dennis and everything. But yeah, we kind of touched the surface, Greg, you know.
He's got a lot of stuff. You guys should see these pictures he has there. I've never seen them before and they're incredible. Matt, I we're running a little long. We have to do our winner for our Facebook poll. The winner is going to get a copy of Ian's and John's book, The Beach Boys in Concert. We're going to give this away. And so, Matt, we're going to pull up our winner here. And once again, if our winner's not on, we'll just pick we have a second one ready. But Matt, let's go ahead and pull our winner of the Facebook. Now, the Facebook question was once again, tell us and share with all of our friends and family here what's your favorite Beach Boys live experience. And so let's pull up our winner.
And you're getting a great gift, by the way. This great prize. This book is awesome.
That's it. Ladies and gentlemen, our winner is Steve Weiner. Steve, are you on tonight? I haven't seen Steve, so I don't know if he's on or not. But he gave an awesome story that I'll read through here real quick. February 1971, I was at a Beach Boys concert at Boston Symphony Hall. Seats and everything opened. Seals and Crofts opened the show. They were good. The boys came on and were great as usual, especially when Carl belted out "Darlin'," one of my favorites. When they did "Good Vibrations," people started dancing in their seats, having a great time. But towards the end of the show, who walks out on stage to surprise the audience and the Beach Boys? I'll tell you who. David Marks. He looked just like he did on the old album covers. Mike went over to him first, and they hugged. Carl and Dennis went over to him. Bruce went up to the mic and simply said, "David Marks." After a minute or so, when things settled down, they got him an electric guitar and a mic, and they did "Surfer Girl," the only time I've ever seen the boys repeat a song at the show, but they had a good reason. I remember wondering if others in the audience knew who he was. Then I realized everyone there was a Beach Boy fan and had the same albums I did and knew exactly who he was. I read in the paper the next day that that was living in Boston while attending Boston's Berklee School of Music. I'll never forget any of the 60s and 70s Beach Boys concerts, but this one was extra special. Matt, what a really, really great story.
And it's fitting since we just talked to John about David Marks. Like, we didn't know that beforehand at all, but it's really must have been something neat, you know, again, David, to be on that. I mean, imagine witnessing that back in the early 70s. It's pretty incredible.
Great
story.
Really
Steve.
Incredible.
Thank you, Steve.
Yeah, Steve, thank you. Thank you so much for sharing that. Thank you, everybody, for sharing I read through all of them, and there were some really, really good ones on there. And some of the stories were incredible. I love the one where Bruce, I forget who did it, man. I don't know if you remember, but Bruce came up afterwards of the show and apologized for Al missing the lyrics in Surfer Girl.
Al forgetting lyrics. Yeah, I forget who said that, but I was like, wow.
Yeah, that's pretty gutsy to walk up. Hey, sorry for all these guys over here. They suck, but great stories. Thank you for participating. Thank you for being a part of this awesome community. We are so blessed and honored. Matt, I love you, brother. Man,
I love you too. That was a great night.
We'll drop
Steve a line and we'll send him the book. I think it's a great story.
It was a good story. So we'll keep it there. So we love you all very much. Next week, we are going to have on a very special guest. But we won't spoil that right now. We'll throw that on our Facebook page and our Instagram as well. Thank you everybody on Facebook, YouTube, and Twitch joining us tonight. We had a huge crowd tonight. It was awesome.
What a guest. I can't wait for part two with him. He reminds me a lot of Fred with the stories and the insights, you know, and just the depth of knowledge. So
absolutely.
Very good. Awesome.
All right, everybody. Hey, have a great night. You be
Thanks
safe.
Thanks to Evan and Scott for our news. Thanks to everybody for joining us.
We'll see you next Tuesday.